And I actually had a question for you. I know that you've made many changes since you've been at the Criminal Justice Training Commission, and you talked a lot about transitioning away from a boot camp or military style approach to training officers towards a process that emphasizes the role as police as part of our communities, as guardians and protectors rather than military warriors. And I know after a long career as an officer yourself, when you got to the CJTC, you replaced the trophy case with the U.S. Constitution and put in place training procedures that include recruits being sprayed with pepper spray so they know what it feels like, instituting psychology classes so trainees can better understand what the people they work with can better understand the people they'll eventually be working with and protecting and interacting with. And I know your methods have not been without skeptics, and so I wondered if you could share with us why you think a new approach to training our young men and women to serve as police officers is needed, especially today, and how these training methods translate to different outcomes or interactions in practice.
Well, thank you for the question. I want to clarify that I don't condemn the training practices in the past. I think we've learned a lot through research and science about how to prepare officers to be more effective. So that's been one of the biggest areas of resistance, is people being offended that somehow by improving our training that we are criticizing what used to be, and that's not the case. We've learned more. In terms of pepper spraying the recruits, many people have misinterpreted that as an attempt to get them to feel empathy. Actually, the reason we do that is we want to put them in a fight for their life stress situation so that they can learn for themselves, that they can overcome extreme pain, extreme fear, and still carry on. When I talk about a guardian mindset, I have to continually reemphasize this is not a kinder, gentler way of doing the job. It's just the opposite. We've actually increased our firearms training. We've increased our defensive tactics training because we want to create strong, effective police officers who have the confidence that they don't have to behave in an intimidating manner. When someone has confidence, that actually tends to de-escalate as well. I think that when we were too focused on the boot camp method of training, it detracted away from our ability to train officers to be critical thinkers. When they were so worried about simply getting the right answer, memorizing checklists, it took away from those critical thinking skills. So what we've tried to shift toward is more of an officer training, the military officers type training, where you really focus on critical thinking and confidence.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that, yesterday President Obama signed an order restricting certain military equipment from going to police, and do you think that's also part of this transition? How do you feel about that?
Well, I want to be clear that many of those pieces of equipment that police departments obtained through the 1033 program are very much needed in the field. When I was sheriff, I can't tell you how many times I needed that armored personnel carrier to either rescue an officer that was pinned down behind gunfire or a citizen that was pinned down behind gunfire. An armored personnel carrier allows police officers and hostage negotiators to get closer to the scene to actually find ways to resolve the conflict without gunfire. Unfortunately, when that program started, there wasn't a lot of accountability and training that went with it. I believe that's what the changes in the law focus on. Police departments will still be able to get armored personnel carriers because they are absolutely necessary to have in the field. The weapons, the rifles, those type of equipment, those are also necessary, and they're less expensive when we get them through the military. So I hope there's an opportunity down the road for people to understand more clearly the benefits of that program, but also the necessity of the accountability that comes with it.
Thank you, and thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll yield back.
Thank General Lee from Washington. The chair would now recognize